Good evening.
Good evening.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I want to share something with you that I've been thinking about for the past few days. You know, as we've been talking about intercessory prayer, I started looking into that. And I found this article from CBN, which I think it's Christian Broadcasting Network. I'm not sure because I've never seen it before. I don't have cable. Anyway, it talks about intercessory prayer, and it says, I'm going to try and not read the whole thing, but it says, what is intercessory prayer? A family member faces a deadly disease. Your neighbor desperately needs Jesus, but turns away every time you try to share Christ. A nation begins to crumble because its people follow their own evil ways. What can you do? Often, the problems we face seem too big for us. No matter how much we try, we cannot solve them on our own. It's times like these when we need to turn to the Lord in intercessory prayer. So what is intercession? Well, intercession is prayer that pleads with God for your needs and the needs of others. But it is also much more than that. Intercession involves taking hold of God's will and refusing to let go until His will comes to pass. Intercession is warfare, the key to God's battle plan for our lives. But the battleground is not of this earth. The Bible says we are not fighting against humans. We are fighting against forces and authorities and against rulers of darkness and spiritual powers in the heavens above. Ephesians 6:12. Intercessory prayer takes place in the spiritual world, where the battles for our own lives, our families, our friends, and our nation are won or lost. So a plan for battle. If you're born again, you're God's son or daughter, John 1:12. As his child, you have a direct hotline to God, Jesus on the main line. At any time, you can boldly come into his presence, Hebrews 4:16. This incredible access to God is the basis for intercession. Once you are in God's presence, you can now discover His battle plan for the situation you are facing. Because prayer alone is not enough. You need a target for your prayers. To discover God's plan, all you have to do is ask. The Bible says that if any of you need wisdom, you should ask God, and it will be given to you. James 1 verse 5. When we ask God for wisdom, His desires will become the focus of our prayers. Let God change the way you think, then you will know how to do everything that is good and pleasing to Him. Romans 12:2. On for battle. Intercessory prayer is a serious matter, and just like soldiers who are preparing for battle, we cannot take on the enemy if we leave our weapons behind. That's why we must go into battle armed for spiritual conflict. And then it points to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4, and it reads, "For though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but we have divine power to destroy strongholds." Then it says, first, recognize that Jesus is in control of the situation. Jesus rules over forces, authorities, powers, and rulers, over all beings in this world, and will rule in the future world as well. Ephesians 1:21. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Then put on all the armor God gives. Ephesians chapter 6. So that you will be ready to fight with God's weapons. These are the weapons of our warfare that can pull down strongholds in the spirit world. They will also protect you from the attacks that are sure to come once you begin the spiritual battle. Next, bind the work of Satan, knowing that Jesus has given you authority to defeat the power of your enemy. Luke 10:19. If God shows you the identity of specific spiritual strongholds that are at work, take authority over these strongholds in the name of Jesus. Always remember that God's spirit is in you and is more powerful than the one that is in the world. 1 John 4:4. Finally, as you begin the spiritual battle, take comfort knowing that you are not alone. Jesus is also interceding on your behalf. The Bible says that Jesus is able to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Hebrews 7:25. And it goes to persisting in battle. Intercessory prayer is also prayer that does not give up. It's the kind of prayer that endures all setbacks and overcomes every obstacle. It's prayer that presses on until we apprehend God's will in whatever situation we are facing. And then it points to Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. And it reads, "Not that I have already obtained this, or I'm already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own." This kind of prayer is the key to seeing breakthroughs in your life and in the life of those around you. Jesus gave a great model for intercession and story of the persistent friend. Here we see a friend who knocks on his neighbor's door at midnight to ask for 3 loaves of bread. The neighbor does not want to get up, but Jesus said, because of his friend's persistence, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Luke 11:8. Then Jesus said, "Everyone who asks will receive, everyone who searches will find, and the door will be open for everyone who knocks." Luke 11:10. Those words mean keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. In God's time, your persistence in intercessory prayer will reap a spiritual harvest in your life and the lives of those around you. And then it says, battling for your nation. Throughout the Bible, God searched for those willing to fight a spiritual battle for their land. In Ezekiel, God says, "And I searched for a man among them who should build up the wall and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found no one." Ezekiel 22:30. Through intercession, you can take the offensive in a spiritual battle, building up your community, your nation, and your world. As you follow God's call to rise up and take your place in the spiritual battle, God promises to heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. Joining the battle. God is calling Christians to join his battle plan for this world, to join in intercessory prayer. He is not looking for perfect prayer warriors, just willing hearts who want to see his will come to pass on the earth. All you have to do is turn to the Lord in prayer. God's word on intercession. We live in this world, but we don't act like its people or fight our battles with the weapons of this world. Instead, we use God's power that can destroy fortresses. We destroy arguments and every bit of pride that keeps anyone from knowing God. We capture people's thoughts and make them obey Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:3 to 5. So as I was reading this and I was thinking about this, you know, we've been talking about the nation, things that are happening right now, that we need to come together and pray for God's movement, because there's a lot of division right now in this country, and we have to bind that, because we're all one nation under God. We're all coming together before him, and that's where we come in. We have to, like it says in here, stand in that hole that there is right now between this nation and God, so that line of communication can continue and God's will is done on this earth. There are a lot of people in this world that are lost. There are a lot of people that are confused, that they think that they know or understand who God is, but then they pick and choose what they want to preach on. When they share the word, they don't share the whole thing. One example of this, I like to read a lot of things that are posted online, news, articles, people's opinions and things like that. And I like to read the comment section of those things a lot. And there was this one particular instance that someone commented, we need to do like Jesus said, and we need to love our neighbor like we love ourselves. So we need to love God with all our hearts. And someone replied to that comment with a scripture from the Old Testament, and that first person replied to that with this verse, and I'm not making this up. The Old Testament was not very Christian.
Oh my word.
Yeah. I started laughing, I almost cried when I read that. But those are the things that we need to pray for for people's eyes. I know it's really funny, but I'm not making it up. For people's spiritual eyes and spiritual ears to be open so they can clearly hear what God is telling them.
Amen.
So that they answer that calling that he's right now making for his people, for this nation. We need to stand together. We need to put that armor that God has given us. We need to stand firm, knowing that what God said is going to happen, it's going to happen, and not let go until it happens. So as we continue to worship here and listen to his word as it's being shared, the testimonies, the things that God put in your heart to share, as we are called to go other places and be participant of things that are being released in this region, let's continue to pursue that he has put in our hearts.
Yes.
And stand for all of those that right now are missing that connection to God.
Yes.
So that once they hear him, that change
yes.
comes and happens
Amen.
Instantly
yes.
and their lives are transformed.
Yes.
Amen.
Any prayer requests or testimonies? Tim.
Yesterday was my day off, and I spent 7 hours in the garden pulling weeds and, you know, getting it to look like a garden. And when I do that, I put a CD player out there and have it blasting messages across the yard on repeat over and over and over. Because you can't just listen once. I mean, there's nuggets over and over again. And as I was listening to, I think it was last week's service, I guess the word is repenting, because that's just changing the way you think.
Mm-hmm.
God pointed out some things in the message that I think maybe it's just simply changing your perspective or how we look at things. He was preaching about when Abraham was called out of the land of Ur or the Chaldees or whatever,
mm-hmm.
and God told him to go, but he took everybody with him.
Mm-hmm.
But if you think about that, you know, it is a little frightening. You know, where am I going? What do you want me to do? That's the way we are. We want to know what God's going to do tomorrow, or what he wants us to say to this person at work, or what we're supposed to do at the grocery store. Or we want to know those things, but he didn't tell us those things.
Mm-hmm.
He just said go.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of times I found myself praying, you know, bring him from the north, the south, the east, and the west. And I heard the Lord say, you need to go to the north, the south, the east, and the west. And the love of God will draw them
yeah.
from the east and in all directions. Because I think of different ones that have come to our church, like Rita and this one and that one. They weren't invited.
Mm-hmm.
God drew them to this church.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the love of God that keeps them here.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, it's a God thing, getting me out of it. And, you know, he talked about hiding, not crawling in some hole somewhere and being a recluse and not involved in anybody's lives, but it's not I that live, but Christ in me.
Yeah.
So when we turn the focus off of ourselves, you know, what am I supposed to say? What am I supposed to do? Where am I supposed to go? And just go and hide in him, the love of God will draw beyond anything we can think or imagine. I mean, everything will be taken care of. the news, and like you said, the it seems like the world's in turmoil, not just in America, but everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I, oddly enough, was thinking of different ones who get so angry at the news, you know, and this one's saying that, and this one's saying that. All I could do was weep, and I thought, this is really weird. And I was just weeping, and my heart hurt so bad for all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, you know what, Lord, you're showing me your heart. That's how you feel about everyone.
Yeah.
And that's why we are to go and hide in you and reveal your heart, and it'll be your heart and your love that will draw them in. Tim.
Yep.
And
I just said, you know.
lift up those that are not here, for whatever reason, that are traveling, for the Lord to keep them safe. Pastor and Sally, they're going to be gone for 2 weeks, to have a good time, godly time, and for God's protection to be with them and come back safe. Anyone else? All right, well, let's stand and come to the Lord. Father, we thank you tonight for bringing us together, gathering your name. We thank you, Lord, for putting your word in our hearts so we can speak it out into this world. We thank you, Lord, for choosing us to be your children. Because we believe in you, Father, we have declared who you are. And we believe in you, Lord. By that, we have earned the right to be your children. We thank you, Father, for giving us your word that we use as weapons of our warfare. We thank you, Father, for giving us the boldness to stand in those gaps, Lord, and intercede for all of those needs, whether are for personal needs or the needs of the nation, to declare your word, Father, that we get a hold of and we don't let go. Thank you, Father, for being with us at all times. And we are praying not only for our needs, but the needs of others. We thank you for giving us, Father, the words that we are supposed to speak and say in all those situations, Lord. We know that you listen to all of our prayers, and everything we speak and declare and pray for in Jesus' name, Lord, goes directly to you. We thank you for giving us your only Son that also intercedes on our behalf. For the sacrifice that he made, Father, of dying on the cross, so that we would be reconciled to you, and we have the opportunity to come boldly through to the throne of grace. Thank you, Father, for everything that you do for us, everything that you have done, that you are doing, and you will continue to do. We thank you for everything that is happening around us, because these things are happening because you are setting things in motion for your glorification, Father, on this earth. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to give you praise and glory, to worship you, Father, and to share your word. We thank you, Lord, because without you, there's nothing that we can do. We thank you for keeping us safe and protected everywhere that we go, because you never abandon us, Father. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to share your word with those that don't know you, so that they come to see your love, Father, experience your love, and come to you answering your call. We lift you up, Father, and we magnify you, and thank you. We glorify you, Lord, and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name. Announcements, this coming Saturday, a prayer burn at Kingdom House of Prayer in Ankeny. This is a 12-hour prayer burn.
This is a time of intercession specifically for our nation. For 12 hours, different worship teams coming in from all over the state of Iowa, prayer teams and worship teams, prayer leaders. Time of intercession for sure. Standing in the gap, time to stand in the gap, and as I posted and sent out to the worship team today, because we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God himself calls his people, his priests, to remember that this is not just the Old Testament, this is for today. And one of the responsibilities of priests was the intercession that stood in the gap.
Yeah.
And we are to stand in the gap with the blood of Jesus being applied to the needs of this country that it needs so desperately, amongst the division and then the hypocrisy upon the denominationalism and and all the traditions of man,
yeah.
All those things that have drawn us away from the pure love of the Lord.
Yeah.
It will be a time that we stand in the gap. We will feel the heat of standing in the gap. We know we've been saved by grace. We know that we are restored, but we're standing into those who don't know. those that are walking in darkness and praying for God's mercy to be upon this land and his grace to be poured out and his love to be shown through the church to
Amen.
This land. So
Amen.
For our set is from five to seven in the afternoon. So either come and join us or pray where you're at. We just need to stand in unity because that's what the enemy wants to do is divide. We just want to stand together.
Amen. All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Eric, would you mind taking the offering?
Somebody crawling through the dirt looking for, you know, a mirage as anything, you know, a drink of water, but that we can come to your house. We're invited, like the prodigal son, that you will put on the table that you've poured out before us in the cup that overflows. You let us drink your living water that never runs dry. Walk into your purpose. And we thank you for loving us and blessing us as we do that. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's lift our hands to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We just love you tonight. Thank you, Lord. We bless you tonight. Thank you, Jesus, that regardless of how things look to us, you have already seen the end from the beginning and declared it. And Father, we trust in your almighty wisdom and power to bring what looks to be chaos and confusion to the fulfillment of your purpose and plan. What the enemy meant for evil, Lord, you can turn for good. Our confidence is in you, Lord, not in man, but in you alone. And we give you the praise and the thanks, Lord, for your great love for all people, for every person. And we thank you tonight in the precious name that is above every name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here tonight. Praise God. Roberto, are you the man on the keyboard? Digitally. Praise the Lord. Amen. Okay, we're going to get right into this because I'm going on vacation. Hallelujah. And I don't want to mail this in, but praise the Lord. No, I'm just kidding. God is good. Amen. And I appreciate Tim and Suzanne and Roberto standing in for us while we're gone, and they'll do a great job. They always do, and God will anoint it. Praise the Lord, because they're preaching out of the good book, amen, and it's always anointed. Hallelujah. So I have great confidence in them because I have even greater confidence in the Lord. Hallelujah. So I know they'll bless you, and so just come and just be part of what God's doing, amen. Thank the Lord. Okay, I want to, let's go to Isaiah, and we'll read chapter 43 of Isaiah, verses 7 through 13. Praise God. I was really blessed by the testimonies and all the sharing that was done Sunday. It was excellent. Tammy, you did a great job in that dream interpretation. That was very good. Praise the Lord. And the way that everything kind of came together was especially cool. And it's the way God does it, you know. I mean, we all have the same spirit, and he speaks to us by the spirit. So if we be sensitive to that, amen, it'll happen this way over and over and over again. He wants out of the mouth of two or three witnesses a thing is established, and God says it to each of us. And then as we share that, those witnesses keep popping up, and it just validates and tells us even more clearly that this is what God is trying to speak to the church. So, amen. That's exciting. Praise the Lord. All right, Isaiah chapter 43, beginning at verse 7. Even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. You know what? Back up to chapter 6, or verse 6. Can you do that? I think it kind of sets this, because otherwise people are going to think we're just talking about the Lord, but I will say to the north, give up; to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Praise the Lord. Even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. We think about this. I don't want to get off too much into the political situation that's going on in the world, but the truth is, what God is saying here in verse 7, too, is that every human being God created for a purpose and for a glory, they all have value, intrinsic value, simply because they were created by God. They may not know that. In fact, many, many probably don't know that. But that's irrelevant. If we know it, exactly, we have to honor it.
Yes.
Amen. It's our Father that has said it. So You know, whether they understand their identity and what God has created them for and the purposes that he has for their life really doesn't change a thing.
No.
It doesn't alter the fact that they are still a part of God's creation and perfect in that sense, and we need to honor that. Praise the Lord. Because that's the only way we can honor the Lord. All right, even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory, I have formed him, yea, I have made him. Bring forth the blind people that have eyes and the deaf that have ears. Let all the nations be gathered together and let the people be assembled. Who among them can declare this and show us former things? Let them bring forth their witnesses that they may be justified, or let them hear and say it is truth. Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. I have declared and have saved, and I have showed when there was no strange God among you. Therefore ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. Yea, before the day was, I am he. Before the day was, I am he. And there is none that can deliver out of my hand. I will work, and who shall let it? Praise the Lord. Now, contrary to popular Christian belief, or doctrine at least, God did not create us to show how powerful he is. Praise the Lord. If that were true, we wouldn't have any choice except to believe that mankind was created as some kind of divine experiment. But God had a plan and a purpose before the foundation of the world. From eternity past, he had a plan, and it wasn't an experiment. It wasn't something he was just going to have like a crapshoot here and see what happens. He had a plan and a purpose, amen, and it is, amen, to show his glory. Hallelujah. Praise God. Isaiah 43, verse 7, if you can back up to that, you'll see, even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory, formed him, yea, I have made him. Praise God. So instead, to be created for God's glory means to understand the riches of his inheritance that is poured out to us. Praise the Lord. So instead of God just doing some divine experiment, he created us for his glory. Amen. And the way that this actually plays out in our lives is we get revelation then poured out to us about how special we are to God. We are his inheritance. And the only, and this isn't, I mean, it isn't about us. I talked about that Sunday. It's all about God. But unless we get to the place where we understand that God values us so highly,
yes,
and has, you know, poured out his love on us so that the love of God can be shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Because my capacity to love is limited. God's is not. Amen. I still have intellect. I still have issues that I got to deal with sometimes to get past obstacles and personalities and so on and so forth that can limit my love, even for God. But God's love is limitless.
Amen.
And if we can receive that, as it was said earlier, we can be hidden in Christ so that the love of God can be shed abroad by the Holy Spirit through us.
Yes.
Amen. It's the Holy Spirit, it's the Spirit of love. Amen, that will shed or spread, amen, that love to this planet. Hallelujah. And God knows we need it. Amen. Hallelujah. Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verses 17 through 19. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding. Remember back in Isaiah where he talked about, give me those people. All these people I've called are going to reveal my glory. And he said, all of them, bring me the ones that have ears but don't hear, the deaf that have ears. Bring me the blind that have eyes. Praise the Lord. God of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. Eyes they have, but they see not. He's not talking about people walking around with a white cane. He's talking about people that have spirit, have the Spirit of God alive in them, but they're not using the Spirit of God to see. They're not seeing by the Spirit. They're not hearing by the Spirit. Praise the Lord. So the eyes of our understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. The glory is the inheritance. The inheritance is the saints. They're one and the same. Praise the Lord. Verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. Praise the Lord. So here's what he's saying. He wants us to recognize as the children of God that he has lavished and continues to lavish this love on us. His love is so, it's the power. Praise the Lord. Amen. It's the power to usward who believe. The love of God.
Yes.
Amen. And that's the same power that works, amen, to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power through us.
Yes.
Again, it's still love.
Yes.
It isn't just brute strength or force. It's not like, you know, he pulls back the shirt or jumps in the phone booth. And I mean, this is who God is. This is what God is.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Identified as love. That's this power that we're talking about. And why would we not understand that when we have the division, we have racial turmoil, we have factions of all kinds, you can just name it, police against civilians, you know, military against civilian, politicians against the people they supposedly represent. All of this is the enemy. I mean, it doesn't take any kind of genius to understand. He goes around sowing seeds of division everywhere he goes. He's a liar, and he wants to bring death because he's a killer. That's what he is. He wants to steal, kill, and to destroy.
Amen.
It's not people we got problems with.
No.
Amen. It's spiritual wickedness in high places that manipulates everybody. Believe me, the devil is no respecter of persons any more than God is. Hallelujah. Amen. We got born again. The color of our skin didn't get born again. Our spirits are all identical. Who we really are. Who God sees us as. The only thing that really matters. The eternal, the unchanging. The Spirit of God that dwells in each one of us has become one with us. Hallelujah. If you can't love another person, then I'm not talking about you just want to run up and give them a big hug and a kiss, but I'm saying if you can't respect and love that person for the creative result of what God has done, then you're missing the most fundamental aspect of Christianity. If it's important to God, if a person is important to God, it has to be important to us. And everybody is important to God.
Yes.
Yes, right.
Hallelujah. Amen. So, 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. You know, the enemy will come in. Look, I've seen this for so long. It's comical because, it would be funny if it wasn't so pathetic. But even within denominations. Now, I was born again in a holiness, Pentecostal church. Jesus' name. I mean, this was rigid stuff. No TVs, no movies, no mixed bathing. And I'm not talking about the bathtub. I'm talking about swimming pools, praise the Lord. No shorts. Amen. No short sleeve shirts. Amen. No beards, no mustaches. Where this stuff came, I'm not sure, but, you know, what the heck. So I got saved there, so I assumed that everything else that was being said there must be true, too. In the town that I lived in East Texas, it was about 12 miles from the Louisiana border. It was a town of about, I think, around 18,000 people, something like that, and there were, I think, four, and at one time five or six, ultimately, when we first lived there, there were four apostolic churches, which is how that church would have been defined, Pentecostal holiness churches. Four of them in a town that size. Now, that doesn't count the Catholic Church, the Baptist Church, the Methodist Churches, the Lutheran Church, all the other churches too. But even within those four churches, we would sometimes go to a revival, and of course it would have to be another one of these churches. We wouldn't go to a revival because the other people were lost and going to hell. They wouldn't, there wasn't no way they were going to have a revival big enough to save any of them, praise the Lord, unless they came to our church. So, I'm just being facetious, but that's kind of was the mentality. And so we would go to another church of the same beliefs. I mean, women, no cutting their hair and the whole thing, you know, the dresses and everything. And so we would go, but here's what would happen. We'd get there, and there the women had to wear their hair up. Now, in our church, they could wear their hair up or they could wear their hair down. They just couldn't cut it. But in this church, unless you wore your hair up on top of your head as a covering, you weren't really sure if you were going to go to heaven or not.
Right.
Now, I know that sounds crazy, but I'm telling you, this is the way it works. And it's not just, I'm not just picking on this particular organization. It happens in all denominations. So, I mean, you know, you'd go away thinking, poor them, you know, I mean, after all these sacrifices they're making, they're still coming up short, you know, they're still going to be lost. And I had such compassion, I'll never forget, when the Lord convicted me. Actually, it wasn't the Lord. It was actually peer pressure, but I thought it was the Lord because I didn't really know the voice of the Lord that well yet, to get rid of my TV. And the reason I subsequently realized it wasn't the Lord was because I felt impressed to give it to my neighbor. I mean, it was going to send me to hell, but he was already going to hell anyway, so I just gave it to him. It just spared me. And I figured, what the heck, you know? He might as well enjoy the trip because he's definitely going to hell. But I'm talking about how we rationalize things in Christianity without really looking at the truth of what God's trying to do. God loves everybody. And nobody is going to do this thing good enough to get to heaven on their own. Jesus had to do it. And because of that, now we want to live good lives. We want to be moral people. We want to reflect our belief. We don't do it as a means by which we can be saved or be rewarded. It's a gift. What we got from God is a gift. Amen? And so God wants us to understand that this is about His love for us, not even about our love for Him. We love Him because He first loved us. We don't even understand love, really, to the degree that God loves us. We feel compelled to love. We feel, I mean, think about this. You want to love God, don't you? I mean, you may not always love God, but you want to love Him, right? If you understand how much He loves you and the sacrifice that He's made for us and all that He's doing for us and all that He will continue to do for us throughout eternity, then you have to, unless you're completely, you know, dysfunctional, you'd have to want to love Him back, right? It's only natural. And God wants us to feel the same way about other people. We may not have the emotion. We may not have the ability to just feel the love, you know, but we can still love them.
Yes.
We can make a decision to love them the same way we do with God. It may be inadequate. It may not be as much as we would like it to be or perfect, but just come on, make the effort.
Exactly.
Love somebody. Amen. And see what God can do in that kind of a situation. Praise the Lord. Whoever it might be, all right? John 3:1. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew Him not. Thank the Lord. God created you so that you might know and experience His goodness. That's why He created you. He created you because He is so full of love. He's not full of love. He just is love. And He created you because He wants some place to put the love.
Right.
He wants to share love.
Yes.
He wants us to experience Him.
Yes.
And the way we experience Him is through love.
Yes.
Now, if you really want to experience God, I think that's a clue. Right? I mean, do we really want to experience God? I'm not just talking about, you know, a light show, a power play. I'm talking about the real, if you really want to experience God, start loving. God is love. You cannot love without experiencing God. Praise God. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God. For God is love. Praise the Lord. Now, let's just do this. I'm going to take this revelation of God, God is love, and combine it with 1 Corinthians 13, which is the chapter, great chapter about love. Amen. And let's just put, everywhere it says God, well, actually in the King James it says charity, but that word translates love. Everywhere it says that, we'll put God, because God is love. They're synonymous terms, right? So here we have it. God is patient. If you want to go there, you can. 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 6. Okay, now I'm just paraphrasing because we're not using the charity, but we're using the exact definition, which is love. God is patient. God is kind. God does not envy. God does not boast. God is not proud. God does not dishonor others. God is not self-seeking. God is not easily angered. God keeps no record of wrongs. If you don't believe that, read Hebrews 11 sometime. He keeps no record of wrongs. Hallelujah. God does not delight in evil, but he rejoices with the truth. God always protects, always trusts. You don't, if you don't believe that, you have missed the fundamental principle of what God has done through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He has created a body in whom he has entrusted this world and his plan and his purpose to operate through us. Tell me God doesn't trust. He's got more confidence in us than we can imagine. He knows what we're capable of by the power of the Holy Spirit and through the power of his love. Hallelujah. Nothing shall be impossible. Amen. He rejoices with the truth. God always protects. He always trusts. He always hopes. He always perseveres. God never fails. Somebody say praise the Lord. Amen. Something you can believe in. Something you can hold on to. Something that you can expect and have a good expectation, amen, as a result of believing God. Amen. Psalms 138 and verse 2. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above thy name. Now here's another aspect that you can have confidence in. This word, God's faithfulness to his word and the fulfillment of his promises are God's highest priority. Praise the Lord. It may just seem like words to some people, but I'm telling you, this is where God has placed his highest priority. He has placed his word above his name. A name that's above every name, by the way. A name at which every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. Amen. To the glory of God. This word he has elevated above everything else. His faithfulness to this word cannot be questioned if you are any kind of a believer at all. Praise the Lord. It's his highest priority, and it's displayed in its fullest in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Amen. The Word made flesh. Yes. Now, for a lot of Christians, the word glory tends to promote more mystery than revelation about God's nature. Now, I had a guy before, and I've had this happen, you know, more than once, not word for word this way, but basically saying the same thing, that would tell me that when they walk into the church, they can tell if God's present or not. Well, I mean, so can I if there's one believer here. He's here, praise the Lord. In fact, even if there wasn't any believer, he'd still be here because he's omnipresent. But I don't want to split hairs with the guy. But nevertheless, he said he could tell if God's if he's here because he could see the glory cloud. And if he sees the glory cloud, then he knows that God is here.
Yeah.
Sounds really spiritual, doesn't it? Makes me want to... Hallelujah. But let me tell you, ironically, a lot of Christians today are like Moses in the Old Testament. Somebody said they weren't very Christian back there. Lord. Hallelujah. See, Moses had this great ministry. He led this huge, I don't know, millions of people. And, he had miracle after miracle after miracle take place. Part in the Red Sea, you know, the cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night, manna, water from the rock, you know, just delivered from Pharaoh, the whole thing. And so he had all this stuff going on there to validate him. But look at this in Exodus chapter 33. Verses 12 and 13. Moses said unto the Lord, "See, thou sayest unto me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight. Now therefore, I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me the way, thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight and consider that this nation is thy people." So, although Moses had experiences that most Christians would call extraordinary glory, right? He still cried out to know God. He said, "God, you know who I am, but you haven't fully shown me who you are. I know you're the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, but personally, I don't really know who you are." See, being in the presence of God, even operating in the supernatural power of God, doesn't necessarily translate into intimacy or fellowship with God. And that was my reason for bringing up what I brought up early on. I saw miracles. We saw multiple miracles in that church in East Texas. And I don't want to sound like I'm being judgmental, but the truth is we didn't really know very much about God. We knew more about God than we knew of God. But it didn't stop him from doing the miraculous, because he has such great love for us.
Yes.
But he still wants us to experience him,
yes,
not just the miraculous. We call that the glory. That isn't what God calls the glory.
Come on.
He says that's just natural. What's glorious to him is us. And we put a high priority on the supernatural, on the miraculous, so to speak, the signs and wonders. But I got to tell you, God's priority is what I'm looking at right now. If it takes a miracle, have a miracle. But he's interested in you.
Amen.
Not what causes other people to get excited. Can't just trust that people who operate in the supernatural or function in that type of a ministry can necessarily give you an understanding of this God who is all about intimacy. He's not, this wasn't, again, this isn't some divine experiment. He had a plan. He had a purpose. The purpose was for you to experience his love. The most important thing that God has, the most powerful thing that God has, is love. And he wants each and every one of us to experience that.
Yes.
Because only by us experiencing it can we then share it with anybody else.
Yes.
There's no other way that we can be faithful to the identity of God and a revelation of God absent love.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how much power you've got,
right,
what you think of as power.
Yeah.
You're playing around with little things when God has the A-bomb. The love bomb, praise the Lord. Amen. And it'll take care of everything else. It'll handle anything else. All right, let's go back to Exodus chapter 33, verse 18. Verse 18 first, and then we'll bounce back and forth. He said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Right? We all remember this. We've heard millions of sermons all around this kind of thing. You know, the rock, in the rock, on the rock, over the rock, behind the rock. It's Jesus. All these things, and I'm not saying those aren't appropriate metaphors and types and shadows and so forth, but let me show you something. Go back to verse 17 here, just before this, the verse just before this. So Moses said, show me your glory. And here's what the Lord had just previously said to Moses, and the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. So then Moses says, show me your glory. Verse 19. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before. What did Moses ask for?
Glory.
Glory. What does God give him? He says, I'm going to give you what you ask. Isn't that what he said? Now, either God's a liar or his goodness is his glory.
Come on.
Yeah.
Again, we're talking synonymous terms here, or God wouldn't have used that. He said, and I will make my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, show mercy upon on whom I will show mercy. Okay? So Moses asked to see God's glory, and God responds, I'll cause my goodness to pass in front of you. God's glory, God's goodness are synonymous.
Yes.
Moses had already experienced the power and the presence of God, as we think of it. The miraculous, the signs and wonders, right? That wasn't his glory. God didn't show him another one of those things. He said, I'll make my goodness pass before you. I'll show you my... I know what your definition of power is. What you think glory is. But I'm going to show you the real deal. Amen? So Moses had experienced this power, the presence of God, but the question he had was, what's your true nature, God? I want to know you. I want to know what you really are. I want to know who you really are. I want to know what you are all about. I want to know what your true nature, your core, your reality is.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen power. I've seen signs. But somehow that isn't enough. It doesn't satisfy me. I don't feel like I really know you. I just know stuff about you. I've seen things, but I haven't experienced you. And God responds by showing Moses his truest nature and his deepest reality. His goodness. Man, if that don't make you want to shout,
come on,
something's wrong. Praise the Lord.
Lord.
Let me show you my power. Let me show you my authority. Let me show you me. And it's his goodness.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
We've done everything we could, when I say we, I mean the church, to scare people into thinking God. What God wants you to understand is he's got power. He's got power over you. He can snuff you out like this. He can put you in hell. He can do whatever he wants to do. And we're like Moses. Thinking because we saw this or we saw that, we've seen the nature of God, the essence of God, the reality of God. And God says, You want to know me? Here's my goodness.
Yes.
This is me.
Yes.
This is reality.
Yes.
Praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 12. And I'm telling you, I know we talk about this over and over and over, but I also know that most of us have lived our lives in the other weirdness of the no TVs and the hair. And I mean, I know those are extremes, but we've all been given our rules and lists that God is demanding when God is just wanting to love and experience us as we experience Him. Amen. So if the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel, glorious, right? Written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. You wouldn't know that by what we just read, but carry on. Praise the Lord. Verse 13.
Amen.
Praise God. Now, God's glory is His goodness. So His goodness is His glory, right?
Amen.
Synonymous, right? So the law was good, but the goodness inherent within the law remained altogether inferior to the surpassing glory of the new covenant.
Amen.
That's available to us through
Amen.
Jesus Christ. For God so loved
yes.
the world, right?
Yes.
So here's the deal. God needed to change us. I was thinking when Eric was praying over the offering, He's changing us.
Yes.
So what God needed to do was change us. He doesn't need to be changed.
No.
Right.
He's love. He's goodness, right?
Right?
So if God needs to change us, Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1. This will be the last scripture. Hebrews 10 verse 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. Praise the Lord. In other words, it could never bring total glory, complete glory. It was always limited glory because we couldn't be perfected. The law placed demands on us that we could not fulfill. We couldn't satisfy. Tell Jesus satisfies the demands of the law so that God's goodness can be displayed and His glory can be revealed.
Yes.
And we are that glory and will continue to reveal the goodness of God throughout eternity.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
So the transformative work of grace that Christ performed at the cross would once and for all open the door for us to be found righteous before God. God's goodness. You hear what I'm saying? It's the righteousness of God that we have received. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. We are God's goodness being revealed in this earth. Amen? God's glory. Give Him a hand tonight. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. So if you don't leave here feeling good about yourself, you need medication. Praise the Lord. And I'll just prescribe Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. He'll satisfy whatever your need is. Amen. Amen. Go in the goodness of God. Amen. Let this world see His glory. Hallelujah. God bless all of you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great couple of weeks. And we'll look forward to seeing you all back here the 31st.